people pretended they didn't know me when they saw me on the street. But I persevered because I knew that if I succeeded, it would be easier and possible for another black woman to be hired and succeed.
Washington, D.C., at the home of media trailblazer Dorothy Butler Gilliam, and she's about to tell us about making black history.
This was a very hard chapter. Mm-hmm.
Before there was Soledad O'Brien, Jemele Hill, April Ryan, or the many black women journalists we admire today, Dorothy Butler Gilliam was on the beat as the first black woman reporter at the Washington Post. Gilliam defied the odds and a racist society to become an award-winning journalist. She covered everything from the civil rights movement to style, writing her own column and serving as president of the National Association of Black Journalists, NABJ. Gilliam also organized and fought for other black journalists to get hired.
So talk to us about what it was like when you first got started.
When I first went to the Washington Post in 1961, it was very difficult because Washington was pretty much a totally segregated city. Taxis would speed by me. And of course, newspapers, you get your assignment in the morning, you go out, you write the story, and you bring it back for deadline. So sometimes I would be so harried as I was trying to get my story, as I tried to get a taxi cab to either go get it or come back. I used the shorthand that I learned when I was in undergraduate school to just start writing my story in shorthand. It was humiliating in many ways. I also couldn't go back to the office and share the incidents that were very painful at times. Again, I knew that if I did that, it would be easy for a white editor to say, well, we tried once, we tried to hire her, but a black woman would, you know, she just couldn't do it. So it was a matter of doing what I had to do and being strong enough to persevere.
Dorothy Butler Gilliam was born in Memphis, Tennessee, one of 10 children and a preacher's kid. She fell in love with writing at 17 years old, eventually graduating cum laude from Lincoln University with a bachelor's degree in journalism.
Immediately, I saw that journalism opened new worlds to me.
But she couldn't get a job at any of the white newspapers she applied to. So she continued working for black media, including publications like the Tri-State Defender and Jet Magazine.
I was able to go to Little Rock. This was a story where President Eisenhower had to send in the troops in order to get 9 black children into the school when white mobs white parents were screaming and yelling. My boss, Mr. Wilson, was brutally beaten. I saw how hard black reporters for the black press worked covering the civil rights story. Very often they were incognito. They would wear, they would pretend to be preachers and, you know, put the Bible under their arm, and they'd have their typewriter wrapped in old clothing. And they would then send their copy by train. Sometimes the Pullman porters helped them.
After Gilliam graduated from Columbia Journalism School in 1961, the only black woman in her class, she eventually started her job at the Washington Post, inspired by Dr. King's call to integrate spaces which once kept black people out. Dorothy would go on to marry artist Sam Gilliam and have 3 children at a time when the women's movement was active. But when she asked for a part-time schedule to balance motherhood and career, her bosses weren't having it.
The editor looked at me and he said, we can't do that, because if we give you extra time off, that we have all kind of men in this room and they would want to have time to write the great American novel. There were not that many women, certainly that many working mothers. So After I had got pregnant with my third child, I quit. And it was actually 7 years later when I was rehired by the Washington Post when I returned to daily journalism.
Today, Gilliam has written her own great American novel, a memoir called Trailblazer, a pioneering journalist's fight to make the media look more like America. The book brought out a crowd of her admirers in New York City, eager to hear the 82-year-old legend tell her own story.
Trailblazer, Dorothy Butler Gilliam.
Thank you so much. I knew
racism made many black people hate themselves.
To be able to see someone who has endured so much and has been able to pave a way for a lot of us who are coming up right now.
Everything she's done has literally paved the way for the opportunities I have today. Like, literally, 10 years in the game. I also went to Columbia's journalism school.
It's time to stop disrespecting African Americans and know that an inclusive America is a strong America.
When you mock or belittle us, you enforce an existing system.
Black women journalists face a new world since Dorothy Butler Gilliam first blazed a trail.
So is it really your birthday, Lee, or did you just want to be on camera?
With new challenges,
the
same old problems with diversity.
And we used to hear when we would go to our white editors and say, you know, we need to have more black reporters. And they would say, we can't find any qualified. And we knew that wasn't true. The Kerner Commission in 1967 really blamed the Daily Press in part for the urban uprisings. And they said the reason this happened is because you have only been looking at America through white eyes. We're still fighting that battle today.
And so what would your advice be to the next generation of reporters? And I'm actually going to be specific here. Can you address black women reporters who are in the field? What would you tell them about how to persevere, how to stay strong, both personally and professionally?
Well, I certainly would not tell them it's an easy job. I would tell them it's an important job. And it's a job that they should come well prepared. They should come determined not to take things personally. They should come ready to really work 24/7, because that's what's involved in being a good journalist. And you pay a price, but it's worth it.
Enough to remember that. This is history, ladies and gentlemen.